ways, as Emily just said, Nehemiah faced a lot of challenges that we don't face. His country was in ruins. He was someone that was in the court of the king. The king, of course, the king of the kingdom, where the exiles from that country lived, the country of Israel. As he went into, he had heard some bad news about how bad it was back in Jerusalem. That those that had kind of slid under the radar and been able to stay reported that the walls had, they were totally decimated. And they still had not rebuilt. And one day, as the cupbearer for the king, which is an important thing, if you're the cupbearer, you have the king's absolute trust. Because if anybody's going to slide something in your drink, and the cupbearer is somebody, you better make sure that you know them well and trust them well. So the cupbearer is someone, of course, that has the king's confidence. So Nehemiah comes into the room, and he must have been somebody that was usually pretty upbeat. Because he comes in and the king says, "Nehemiah, what's the matter? Tell me. Something has you very upset today." And he started telling him about the stories that he heard of Jerusalem. And he said, "I have to go." At that point, the king says, what do you want? He says, "I'd like to go." The king says, "Great." He goes, "Okay, well, while I'm asking, king, can you send the stuff to rebuild the walls? And send a letter that says that this is by your authority, so that when I get there, they won't tell me to stop." Well, the king sends this letter and sends these supplies. And Nehemiah comes, and he gets there, and again, he's taking this long trip under the authority of the king. And he gets there, and it says he goes around kind of at night. He grabs some of his closest folks that are with him, and they go around the walls. And they see, as they go around the walls, the stones that once were the proud parts of their defense for the city of Jerusalem. They see it in ruin, and the stones tumble. And he comes back, and as he's even going around the city, he realizes that there's nothing really that's there. They're going to have to start over. So he begins to preach the message, "We're going to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem." Well, for the people that don't live in Jerusalem and kind of like that Jerusalem has been brought down and brought low, they don't respond well. And the story before our chapter, they're kind of the ones that are, they're always, "Nehemiah, stop. Nehemiah, stop. Nehemiah, stop." Nehemiah says, "Can't stop." And it's interesting, if you go through, Ryan, I appreciate you reading all those really fun words, everybody's names. We read, if you're in your prayer calendar, you'll notice that a few weeks ago we read some of the other ones in chapter 3. If you really want to have an exercise of making sure you just get everyone's name wrong, I invite you to read chapter 3 aloud. Just if you want your own little lesson in humility. I tried that in front of everyone at Bible study, and they found out that even the preacher doesn't know a lot of these names. But in chapter 3, there's an interesting part that takes place. He doesn't go to every person and say, "We're going to rebuild the entire walls of Jerusalem." He says, "Oh, here, this family, you guys have this section. Your family, oh, you have this section. And then presently, you have this section, and this section, and this section. You can do this, and you can do this." And as each person and their family and their groups took one section of the wall, all of a sudden they looked around and they said, "Wow." As you heard in the beginning of this scripture in chapter 6, now it got reported to Sanballat and Tobiah and to Geshem. and to the rest of our enemies that I had built the wall and that there was no gap left in it. Now, Nehemiah didn't build the wall. Each family built the wall. And they didn't build the whole wall. They built the part God had given them to build. And then they realized the gates weren't there, and it still was, there's no gap in it, but it's this big. Okay, that doesn't really stop too many armies. You know, everybody gets to the wall, and what do? They just step over it. Because it's only this tall. But it was built. And there was a victory even in having no gap in the wall. And so Sanballat, he starts coming, he's like, okay, we're going to have a conference about this. So Nehemiah, we see your economic stop. Okay, so you're building, you're still building. Stop. Come here. What's Nehemiah's response? Why should, and I'm doing a great work and I cannot come down. Why should the work stop while I come down to you? Four times they keep questioning Nehemiah. And Nehemiah's response, I can't stop. Why should I stop to come down when I know you're just going to try to slow me down? I can't stop. So they ratchet up the next level. They say, oh, you have a letter from the king, do you? Guess what? We're going to write a letter from the king. So I write in my name, and of course Geshem, he's one of the guys that's sitting right there with him. And Geshem, he saw the same thing. He saw you trying to, you're going to build this wall to rebel against the king. We're going to make you stop in the name of the king. Nehemiah says, send your letter. I still can't stop. Because what you're saying is not true. And so go ahead, send it. Because the king knows me. Why? He was the trusted confidant of the king. I would imagine that a cupbearer probably got the first sip. So if it's going to kill the king, it's going to not get to the king. And you're going to accuse Nehemiah now of rebelling against the king. Go ahead. Give it a shot. Well, that obviously doesn't work. They keep building and they keep building until the wall is rebuilt. And there's a prayer in the midst of this. Lord, you've seen what they have, but now, O God, strengthen my hands. And it says that the passage that we skipped over a little bit, verses 10 through 14, this is somebody even from within the people of Israel tries to stop. They join up with the others and they try to trick him to stop. And he still never stops. So it says in verse 15, so the wall was finished on the 25th day of the month of Elul in 52 days. In 52 days, they rebuilt the walls of Jerusalem. Something only God could do in this. And all their enemies heard it and they were afraid. Their enemies heard it and they were afraid because they knew that that wasn't Nehemiah building it. It wasn't even each family building it. Because they realized, they said, that's God. Only God can do what they just did. And so they rebuilt it according to the word of God. Can't help but think that this passage applies to us today. I know some of you are thinking, well, that's because we have a building program. Can we build a church in 52 days? If God tells us to. I think instead of thinking of the building specifically, because in the 40 days of prayer, we've been talking about even more than the building, we've been asking, Lord, give us direction for our church. You'll see. Last week, we finished the service as each one came up for communion. They placed prayers up here. And these prayers now are on our altar. And I invite you after church to come up and to read these. And to hear the prayers. And it'll bring tears to your eyes. It brought tears to my eyes as I read through the passion behind these prayers. for courage, for boldness, for new disciples, for new friends, for our faith family, for prayer, for so many things. I'd love for us in the midst of that prayer to walk around our city with a few of our closest friends and see what we might see. You know, as we walk around each day with your eyes saying, Lord, what would you have me build in my life? Which part of the wall do you want me to be responsible for? It may be that you come across a friend who's in the midst of a marriage that's in crisis. I dare say that that's a stone that once was strong, now is down. And God's saying, you can put that stone up. It might be that as we go to Vic Elementary, we say, here's a child that otherwise would fall through the cracks. I see a sheep of God's fold. And God's saying, oh, tend to my sheep. Feed my lamb. And you say, I can pick that stone up and put it in its place. There are many places that as we walk through life in this city, in this place, in this time, that God is going to speak to us and say, here's where I want you to build. Here's the place that I want you to make a way for that person to receive the good news of Christ. What is our mission? It's to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. It may be that God shows something else to you, something that we don't even see right now. Where is God calling you in your life to build the wall? Where is he saying, here's the gap that you can fix? Because there's something in each of us that God is calling us to do. You know, one of the things I loved about when Denny was sharing a little bit ago, he said it was really great to hear from someone that's already been through what I've been through. Some of you have been through a storm in your life at one point, and there's somebody that the storm is raging for. And if you're going around the city saying, Lord, where can I build? Lord, what can I do? God's going to say, do you see that one? You've walked through that valley, and I've been with you. And now there's someone else in that valley, and they need your helping hand. We walk with them. You know, as a church, I've walked around, and I know that a number of you have as well, and I've seen places in our culture, and we're going to be trying to answer some of the needs that we see. And we're going to be offering Financial Peace University, because I don't know if you've noticed this, there's not a lot of financial peace right now in our culture. In January, we're going to start Financial Peace University, and we're going to offer that. Yes, you're invited to Financial Peace University. And it's not here just for you. Because you've got a coworker that's not, they would love to be only up to their eyeballs in debt. They're probably so far underwater, you don't even know that they may be two steps from being bankrupt or homeless. And you say, hey, you know, I'm going to be going to this class for Financial Peace University. Will you come with me? And just by being sensitive to the Spirit enough to offer that small invitation, you've heard God saying, here's your spot in the wall. You know, we have some material that's going to come out next year. I have it already. We're just trying to figure out exactly when it's going to fit into the church schedule. Marriage is built to last. Because we're in a culture right now where marriage is under siege. And the church should be the place that's the sanctuary for restoration and rebuilding and rekindling and refiring the love, not just of a couple, but the love of God for each one in that couple. And then in the midst of that love, repairing relationships, restoring broken families. And that's one place I see brokenness in our city and in our world that God may be calling us to put that stone up. Oh, there are other ways. Mary in the garden. You know, I had a chance this week at pilgrimage. People were saying, which church are you from? And I said, oh, I'm from Winstead. And Wilson, they said, oh, what's God doing there? I said, well, let me tell you, we can't say we've not broken ground on our new property. Because we've broken ground in the name of feeding the hungry. And I love Don's quote in the paper. We can't feed the world, but we can feed Wilson. You're not hearing that saying, God saying, here's your gap. Here's your spot. As we grow, ways to feed the hungry. Yeah, and as we look at our building plans, I truly believe that as we're looking at the needs of the city, it will change the way we build. It will change the way we respond. Because what we're going to be building is not a church that's for us. It's so that through us, we can be the church for the world. And that makes a huge difference. You know, we've talked about the question being not how do we build the best church in town, but how are we going to be the best church for our town? Being sent by God to the places where we're called to go and build the wall. Now, the world's going to tell us, stop. Now, we might not recognize it as the devil, you know, because chances are there's going to be somebody in a big set of red tights and a pitchfork, you know, standing at the door of the property going, not here, not here. It's going to be somebody that is looking out for their own interests, like Sandor. And he's going to come at us from ways we might not even expect right now. And he's going to say, it's time to come down from the wall. It's time to stop praying for the persecuted church around the world. It's time to stop feeding the hungry and get about the business of being a church when that is the business of the church. It's the quiet voice that says, aren't you too busy to do one more thing for God? You know, when we're doing Bible study in Hood Hall, we shouldn't fit. Because we can't stop listening to what God tells us to go and do. We should be overflowing with people saying, like, I'm not sure which child it was, so I'm not talking about your child. I can't leave what God's doing. It might mean that you hear the call to be a little league coach, because you can help kids have an example that they might not see otherwise. Or a tutor in the school. Or just a helping hand for the people around. God's going to speak to you and to us as we keep looking around the city, saying, Lord, what will you have us do? You know, as we close today, I want you to think about not just these prayers. First of all, the clipboard for the 40 days of prayer. I mean, the prayer video. Where's the clipboard? Oh. And we got the clipboard. Clipboard's back that way. Good, okay. But keep passing the clipboard, by the way. You've got it. Keep passing it. The sheet, and I know that Priscilla talked about this, the sheet for the 40, I hope you're all doing the 40 days of prayer. We're in the last week, finishing with a prayer vigil. We're going to start next Saturday morning with a time of prayer, half an hour. And then asking you to give a half an hour sometime in the rest of the day. Or if you're like me and you're a night owl, we're asking you to do an hour. Not because we want to double your work, but because we think that if you're getting up at 2 o'clock in the morning and come pray, it might take you 30 minutes just to get your mind geared up. I've heard some of you say, well, I don't know what to pray for. If you go through and you pray over each one of these prayers, and there's a sheet, by the way, right outside the door out here for you to add your prayer to these. as you pray, you can pray for these things. You can sit in silence. You know, a lot of times we come to God and we've got our to-do list for the Lord. You know, Lord, while you're shopping, will you pick up some healing for me and some things for me and some things for me? And God's going, I want to have a relationship with you. I'm glad you brought me your to-do list. But imagine, you know, for you that are married, the only thing you said to your spouse was, here's what I want. But we need to spend also some time saying, Lord, I love you. Lord, just speak to me. Let me hear your voice. Can't do that if you keep talking and God's trying to get a word in. You know, you can imagine a phone conversation. Lord, I love you. You're great. Would you give me this? Would you give me that? And, oh, it's been great talking to you, God. God's going, I want to speak to you, but you didn't give me the time. As we go around the walls of the city, as we listen to the Lord, the word of the Lord, as he tells us which gap are we called to fill, listen to God. Because he'll direct you. And who knows what he might do. It may be that in 52 days, whatever that looks like for us, he's going to keep building on this 40 days of prayer, on a day of prayer, as we turn to look towards the birth of Christ. And the birth of Christ, his birthday, gives us a chance to tell the world about Jesus. That's going to be another opportunity for us to say, I love the Lord, do you love him too? And we'll talk about, I have a number of weeks to talk about that, but that's going to be one more stone we can build. It's by bridging that gap from our society to celebrate the coming of Christ. The challenge for you today is, are you standing at the ready, at the wall? Are you standing ready to pick up a stone and put it where it needs to go? There were other people in that contingent, they stood guard. I would say that those are the ones that are praying. And maybe you can't do a lot of different things. Maybe you're someone that just physically, you can't go and do maybe like you used to. You can stand guard by lifting up your church in prayer, by lifting up your neighbors in prayer, by lifting up your families in prayer, so that when the attacks come, they got no place to go. Because you've stood in the gap and you've prayed for them. Are you willing today to say, Lord, I want my life to mean something. I want my faith life to mean more than just coming to church on Sunday morning. Because the worship here is to lead us to be worship out there. And then this week, are you willing to say, Lord, I want your eyes on my eyes this week, that I might see my world, my city, the way you see it. So when you read the newspaper and you hear about different situations, violence, brokenness, maybe you'll hear it saying, is that a gap, Lord, that you're calling our church to fill? Lord, how can I be your hands and your feet to this person, this place, this situation? Lord, what can I do? And then when the world or our neighbor or even sometimes our own agenda, when it says that you've got to stop, you know, don't be silly about God like this. Come down off that wall. Don't stop. I mean, even name it. In the name of Jesus Christ, I can't stop. In the name of Jesus Christ, we can't stop. We've got God work to do. And if we stop doing it, it's not going to get done. But oh, the Lord is calling us, and He's saying, don't stop. Don't stop. Don't stop. And it may be that when we're finished, we've turned around and we've looked to see what God has done, and we've said, oh, praise be to God. I'm so glad I was a part of it. But I know, Lord, that it's not your, that it wasn't my hands, it's your hands that have been at work within me, within us. Because we couldn't stop. So who's with me? I'm going to give you a chance to, if you're with me, join me in prayer. As we continue to pray for the church and for direction, we're going to sing here in just a moment. But as we sing, I invite you to come and pray. Pray for holy boldness. Acts for boldness that impacts not just our lives, but the life of the world. Let's pray. Lord, maybe there's someone that came in the doors this morning thinking they were just coming to church. And your Spirit has been speaking to them today. You've given them a chance to pledge themselves again to your cause. To praying for the persecuted church, to praying for our mission as a church, to praying for maybe they're looking for direction in their own life and want to know what you would do with that. Then Lord, hear those prayers today. Lord, I ask you that in the power of your Holy Spirit that you will not let us go today, Lord, until we have reached out and grabbed your hand and said, Lord, no matter what comes, I will not stop. I will not come down. If my health may fail me, my work falls, my family ridicules me, if my bank book gets emptied, Lord, I will not stop. I'm clinging to you today. And then, Lord, send us forward into our city this week with your eyes, that we might see with fresh vision the brokenness that is around us, where you have called us to be the city set on a hill, with a light that cannot be hid. That you have called us to be salt to the world, to be the balm that restores brokenness, not through our hands, but through the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, make us bold. Give us your strength and your power, that we would say to the world, we cannot stop your work. Lord, fill us in that way today. As we stand to sing, I invite you to finish our prayer to come forward if you'd like to.